deal with, which is people with housing costs. And so they are hopefully learning, and that is both on how you deal with people. Part of the report mentions things like channel shift, making people work online. These are some of the people who are most unlikely to use channel shift at the moment, is how you encourage them. That's part of what the pilot has been doing. Effectively, from what we understand from those pilots, they are taking it carefully to try and make sure this is a major change, moving people, moving benefits together. At the moment, we are not getting reports of any major changes, but I would emphasise the numbers nationally are still at this stage fairly small, and clearly volume brings with it its own problems as it racks up the numbers of people who will be on this benefit.
Sorry, just a quick subject matter. What I'm really saying is you don't anticipate, from what you know of it, and I know you're an expert in this market, you don't anticipate any problem with its introduction from what you've seen so far.
Thus far, no, there are none that we've seen thus far.
I don't need to declare an interest because I've been interviewed through my job at Age UK for some of the digital inclusion bit, so I don't know if that needs to be declared as an interest. But I'm really, really concerned because the conversation that I had with them, it was to do around the fulfillment that we do, and it's talking about people who are socially isolated, disabled, in their own homes with no access to IT. Basically, the way this is going forward is they're practically being cut off from benefits unless something is thought about. So I've got some real concerns, and I know Mark will be painted a very rosy picture of what is not a rosy landscape as it goes forward to anybody who's had anything to do with it. I know it's going to be very, very difficult, but it's the most vulnerable people in our society who are going to suffer more than anything else, and I think we need to keep a very, very close eye on how this is rolled out. My understanding is that once you are on universal credit, there will be some form of how people will remain on universal credit. So effectively, yes, if someone moves from Wellington to here, that's going to be an issue. We've not come across any of that so far. That will be dealt with directly by DWP. My understanding is that they don't go back on and back off to different things. The initial one is as people move in, because similarly, if people are here and move to Warrington and qualify on a very restricted basis that is currently, they would move immediately to university credits. We've not got any details, nor can I say, yes, we know there are people here on university credits who've come from any one of the seven pilots that have come from. Just as an add-on, if we get as this develops, if you do find, because I've sort of told you, don't apply online to the benefits, it's as simple as that. There's no other way around it. So there are benefits that go around, like carers and attendance and that are going on to the university credits. Are we going to do anything to support people who can't apply?
Again, to be shared with our other area of responsibility, particularly with regards to libraries and one-stop shops, part of our network is to actually have IT that is capable for people, particularly as you mentioned before, that can't access IT. Part of this report mentions things like the local support services framework. That will be an issue that we will discuss with DWP as we as a local authority should we assist people who are not able to do it for themselves to be the first line support to get them an access point, which will go to DWP online, because yes, you are correct, fundamentally this will be an online benefit. Can we support them, and how much information support do we give them, rather than from the standpoint of saying there's an IT,
we can log you into DWP, often go by yourself, down to whether or not we can actually support them, which is obviously what a lot of monitoring community sector are also looking at, how they can give advice. So effectively, yes, we are trying to look at what we can do, particularly with regards to face-to-face. The whole idea of this, like so much of them, the channel shift, is to move people away from the initial handling. Once they've done it, once to be able to do it for themselves. Now that is a challenge, as we found with a number of services that we're trying to move on to challenge here, and this is a major one. I don't think it does diminish the difficulty that FACE is getting, to use the percentage of the last 10% on, to try and look at those, and that's why the DWP, as I've detailed in the report, are looking at some of these pilots to see how they can best help people onto it. But yes, as a local authority, we were looking there initially, but again, as the report does suggest, clearly how much support can we give them will probably depend on what the DWP A expect us to do, and effectively how they will fund any support that will be given, either by ourselves or even by voluntary community sector bodies. We can't have an English of people without some level of funding, and that in part is my understanding. That's why the pilots are there.
It's just then lies the problem, what you just said. It's how do we get the last 10%? And the 10% just happen to be the most vulnerable, who can't come into the land, who are socially isolated at home, then with no IT access. So we need to take them up with a laptop to help, and all the data protection issues and all of that funding. So it is going to be a major problem. So we are aware of all.
Again, one of the issues is this isn't going to be a local authority benefit, this is a DWP-led benefit, a local authority, again, as the report suggests. We are there to try and help support that move over towards universal pace. And yes, I think we do acknowledge the amount of issues that we, as a local authority, in our main corporate guises, are going to still come out of this, which is why, in a way, this slow move towards it should try and help us at least be aware of what's coming for us to support.
No further questions. Close that. The simple motion. Agreed. Thank you, Mark. Next one is the joint cross review notes.
Thank you, Chair. This report outlines the process that's been taking place to establish joint health scrutiny protocol or arrangements for how a joint health scrutiny committee will be established across Cheshire and Merseyside. The reason for this is that there's been changes to the health scrutiny regulations that came into effect from the 1st of April 2013. In terms of health scrutiny, review scrutiny committees have powers which relate to the scrutiny of health services. So where health services propose changes in services, scrutiny committees have the power to refer a proposal to the Secretary of State if they believe that it's not in the interest of the health service or they have not been adequately consulted on the proposal in that area. Now, the significant change from these new regulations is that where a proposed change in the degree of health services is on a larger footprint than a single local authority, that is a requirement for those authorities that deem that change to be substantial to actually come together and form a joint health scrutiny committee for the purposes of that consultation and for that consultation with the proposed health service change. The report sets out the draft protocol is attached as appendix 1 to the report. The draft protocol sets out it's really the vehicle for how a joint committee will be established. And the process that's set out indicates two stages really, the first stage being that the proposed change would go to each individual local authority, to the health scrutiny committee, to determine if that is indeed regarded as a substantial change in that local authority area. And then for those authorities where that change is deemed to be substantial, a substantial variation, the protocol articulates how those committees would be set up. It's important to point out that on page page 50. 60, in the protocol on page 69, there are proposals for how membership would be derived from each of the authorities. And there's been a change in the protocol since these members were published. And so it's important to set out what that is now. It's considered to be probably a more favourable position because the proposal here indicates that there were 8 or more authorities in Cheshire and Sad area formed to a committee. It would be one member from those authorities. As you can see from that,